Minecraft 1.21.2 just came out this morning, and by my estimate, that means that a lot of you are probably going to be wondering right about now why your datapacks have completely stopped working. So as you may have been able to guess from the title, this video is going to basically just be a rundown of everything that could have possibly broken your datapack to help you update to the new version. Okay, so the first big change, and probably the most severe breaking change in this entire version, is the change to attributes. So what I've got right here are a bunch of commands in the format that would have worked in the previous version. Player.blockInteractionRange, we've got zombie.spawnReinforcements, and then we've got a generic one, generic.attackDamage, and I've gone ahead and shown them in different contexts, so the attribute command, attributes on enemies, and then attribute modifiers on items, just to show that these are used in many, many different places. The change is that these prefixes have all been removed. So here is that same function in 1.21.2. The attributes are just called block interaction range, or you can also do like Minecraft colon block interaction range, that works as well. Zombie.spawnReinforcements is just spawn reinforcements, and then generic.attackDamage is just attack damage. This change applies to all attributes. Every single one of them no longer has that prefix out in front. And as I've kind of tried to show here, it applies to every single location where an attribute can possibly appear. So commands, entity NBT, item NBT, as well as things like enchantments. So just anywhere you see an attribute, just remove all the prefixes and your datapack should be good for this new version. So next up, we've got some changes to item components. First up, the food component was pretty much entirely overhauled. So I've kind of written a command right here for a really, really long food component that you could have done in the previous version. And I've included pretty much everything I can. So nutrition, saturation, the can always eat seconds, using converts to, and then effects to apply when you eat that food. Now in the new version, this component has actually been split up into many components. So food still has nutrition, saturation, and can always eat. The using converts to field is now its own component. It's now just use remainder. And then the rest of all those fields were moved to this new consumable component. Eat seconds is now consume seconds. Effects is now on consume effects, and it looks a little bit different, and here's an example of how you would upgrade the previous effects to the new format. And there's a little bit more nuance with this consumable component. The consumable component is now the only way to make an item consumable. So before, the food component did that entirely by itself. But now, if I give myself an item that is not normally food, so I'm doing a brick here, if I give myself an item that's not normally food and I just put the food component on it, I am right-clicking, you won't be able to eat it. All the food component does is define the stats that will later be used by the consumable component. So in this new version, if I want an item to be consumable that normally isn't, I have to add the consumable component, but I can just leave it empty. So if I just do that, now I can eat this brick. And in fact, if the only reason you had the food component on that item in the first place was to just make it consumable but not give it any effects, then consumable on its own will actually achieve that now. So I can eat this brick. And if you don't specify the food component, the can always eat defaults to true. If you do specify the food component, can always eat defaults to false, which is a little bit confusing, but just takes a little bit to remember. But yeah, if you just follow the format that I've kind of laid out here, where you convert this to this, then everything should work. Remember that the point of this video is not to showcase any of the new stuff, it's to just get an existing data pack working in the new version, and nothing else. Alright, and next up we've got another component change. So before, we could define items that were fire resistant, which basically, if they had this component, you could throw them into fire or lava, and then they wouldn't burn, which of course was used in vanilla by all netherite equipment. And now that component is a little bit more versatile. It's no longer called fire resistant, it's just called damage resistant. And it's got this new argument called types, where you have to specify a damage type tag that the item will be immune to. So if you wanted your item to be fire resistant before, to maintain that same functionality, you now have to add this hashtag is fire tag under the types field. Up next, we've got changes to locking chests and other chest-like containers. So a very little known feature about Minecraft chests and barrels and things like that is that you can actually give them some NBT to prevent players from opening them. Like this, for example. This chest is locked. I'm right-clicking on it and I cannot open it. This is an entirely vanilla feature. I don't know how many of you know about this, but it's pretty cool. Now this feature has been around for a long time, but in this version it was pretty much completely overhauled. So before, you had to just give it a lock that was a simple string, and then in order to open the chest, you needed to have an item with the same custom name as this string. So this is the set block form of that command, and then you could also give yourself a chest that has a lock component, and it's also just that string. That was the old format, here's the new format. The string has been replaced with an item predicate, and that item predicate is the same style that you normally put in custom advancements and predicates and stuff like that. So the lock field on the place chest has been made lowercase, it's now lowercase L, and rather than just having a string, you now, like I said, you put in an item predicate, and to keep the chest working exactly the same way it was before, where you you need an item that is named a certain custom name in order to open the chest, you just make an item predicate that searches for that custom name. There's a lot more you can search for as well, but that's kind of outside the scope of this video. The item component now also has exactly the same form, so you just make an item predicate that searches for an item with that custom name. And then if I just give myself an item that has the custom name chest key, which is exactly what it is searching for, then with this item, I will be able to open the chest, and if I'm not holding it, then it'll be locked. And finally, in changes to commands and functions and stuff like that, we have a change to the boat. So boats are now a whole bunch of different entities. So before, we had just the boat and the chest boat, and then in order to change what type of boat it was, you'd use this type field right here. In the new version, those types are their own entities. So you have dark oak boat, you have bamboo raft, and then you have, like, mangrove chest boat. They're now completely distinct entity types. So you'll have to consider whatever implications that brings with it. The next change involves advancements, and specifically this trigger called Killed by Crossbow. So in case you weren't aware, in the previous version, the Killed by Crossbow trigger would trigger exactly like it sounds whenever you kill an enemy with a crossbow. Now in this new version, they have expanded this trigger's functionality a bit, and that comes with a few ramifications that I have to talk about here. So it's no longer called Killed by Crossbow, it's now called Killed by Arrow, and it triggers any time you kill an entity with any arrow shot from a bow or a crossbow or whatever. Now the implication is that in the previous version, if you wanted to only trigger the advancement when the entity was killed with a crossbow, you now have to use this new condition that that trigger has called Fired from Weapon, and then you just put an item predicate right here that searches for a crossbow. And like I keep saying, that is what is required to keep the same functionality that we had before. The trigger got more broad in its scope, so you've got to put in a condition to narrow that scope back down. Up next, we've got a pretty minor change to custom enchantments, where if you were using this entity effect called Damage Item, the only change is that its name has been changed to Change Item Damage. If you were using item damage in the previous version, and you only make that change, then you should be good. Now the reason it was changed is that it now accepts negative values in order to heal your item, which was not possible before. So if you're thinking, why on earth did they make this change? I mean, it's at least a little bit understandable. Now, another thing to note is that there's actually a component, it's a value effect component, called Item Damaged. That one is completely different and was completely unchanged in this version, so do not get the two mixed up. Up next, we've got a change to loot tables, where this loot table, Minecraft Empty, no longer exists in the game. Now, I don't know why any of you would be using this, because the entire point of the loot table was that it was an empty loot table, but it's possible that some of you were using it as a placeholder to not drop any items. So if you wanted to have a 50% chance to drop a stick, for example, you could have one entry that was the stick and then one entry that was the empty loot table. This is no longer possible because this loot table no longer exists. Now, the workaround is something that has always been possible, but is now more required, and that's just to use the empty type rather than putting in the empty loot table. This is a really easy change to make, and you probably already should have been doing this, but if you weren't, this is how you do it now. And last but not least, we have a pretty big overhaul to the way recipes work. So in most recipes, including crafting shaped, which is what this example is, you usually had to specify this kind of object with either an item or a tag somewhere in the recipe. Now with the crafting shaped, you just specify it as part of the key field, but there's a whole bunch of other recipe types that use this format as well. So you could either have an object with an item, an object with a tag, and the tag did not have the little hashtag at the beginning, or you could have a list of those objects. This is no longer the case. In the new version, it's put in directly as either the name of the item, the name of the tag, and it does have the hashtag to separate it from items, or just a list of items. Now, looking back at the previous version, you can probably tell that this new version is actually a lot more compact, and it looks a lot nicer, but I should point out that there is one slight loss of functionality here, and it's not that big a deal. Before, you were allowed to put a tag object inside of one of these lists. And in the new version, if you try that, so if I were to put hashtag Minecraft planks right here, this is actually not allowed. It's a little bit annoying, but there is a pretty easy workaround, and that is that rather than using a list in the first place, you just make your own tag with all of those items and tags and whatever, because tags can reference other tags, of course, and then you reference that tag in the recipe. But other than that, this is how you do recipes now. Personally, I like this change a lot. Now, there is one final little change, and I think it's hardly even worth mentioning, but it does have something to do with recipes. In the previous version, there was a recipe type called Crafting Special Shulker Box Coloring. That recipe type no longer exists, and it now takes the form of the new recipe type called Crafting Transmute. Now, I doubt there was a single person on Earth who was actually using Crafting Special Shulker Box Coloring, because it was incredibly hard-coded, and the recipes that used it were already pretty much fully implemented in the vanilla game. But if for some crazy reason you were using that recipe type, you now want to use Crafting Transmute, and the options for Crafting Transmute are fully available on the wiki. And with that, that should be everything. If you just follow this guide and you had a data pack that was previously working in 1.21 or 1.21.1, and then you follow everything I said here, you should get your pack working in 1.21.2. Thank you for watching, my dudes. I hope you found this helpful. I will see you all later. So if I want to make this item consumable, I now have to add get it? It is a tradition at this point that in every video I get interrupted by a train. That the reality I am coming to accept.